Hello, hello, hello to all the music lovers out there. I am your girl, Marquita Sharon, and today I come to you on behalf of Concert Daily as we are all in awe and seriously elated to introduce to you the amazing, poised, sophisticated singer-songwriter and overall highly acclaimed vocalist and lead singer of the highly respected music group, M2ME. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Miss Tawatha AG. How are you?
That was such a great introduction. It's like, what was she talking about? No, I'm doing very well. I'm doing very well. And I'm so happy to be talking to you.
Thank you. I am elated to be talking to you. I mean, the history behind your name.
Speaking of names, I have a niece named Marquita and a niece named Sharon. So
this is amazing.
I'm serious.
That is awesome.
Amazing. Okay.
Yes, that is awesome.
Okay, I'm sorry, but back to business.
No problem at all. I love the interaction, definitely. The movement that you have made throughout the years is simply incredible. I don't even know where I want to start with you because it's just so much. But because we are located in the DMV, D.C., Maryland, and Virginia area, I want to actually start with your interaction with this area and you being at Howard and you singing with Richard Smallwood and Angela Winbush and all of these great people early on.
I think things were like destined to happen. I just happened to be in that place. We were all students. Angela and I were students there, and Shelton Becton, the other young man who's in the photo. We all just happened to be music majors, and you know, in the basement of the Fine Arts Building is called the rehearsal rooms, and we'd be down there just singing. And then one day, I heard Angela singing. I walked in her room and said, "Wow, you sound great." You know, we stayed in the same dormitory. I mean, you know, it was just one of those things. We just happened to click. And we started writing songs together, and we went to each other's churches, I mean, as well as being students in the College of Fine Arts. So, I mean, you know, and Richard was, we went to Richard's father's church. And so it was just like everything was connected. Everything was connected. So I think it was just supposed to be kids that got together, wrote some music. And, you know, we all went our separate ways upon graduation, but we've all become very successful in our careers, which is the true story. So, I mean, and we still stay in touch.
Yes. Oh, my. Round of applause to that, because that right there.
Oh, absolutely.
That connection and longevity of friendship is so important, especially when you all do similar things. Like, how incredible is that? I have a quick story about Shelton Becton that my mother told me when she found out that I was going to be speaking with you. She told me that she went to a concert ways ago because my uncles actually were very good friends with him. So I'm sure you guys have all passed, you know, have literally crossed paths before. I just thought that was so interesting. I wanted her to be able to pull the pictures, but she couldn't do that.
Shelton, I mean, his Aunt Velma, and we would go to her house. She taught us table manners. You know, she said, in case one day you become famous, you'll know how to use the right fork.
She was on to something.
World.
She knew. She knew. She knew it was going to actually come to pass.
Yes.
So on the... Talking of longevity of friendship, you were in a group eventually called Hat Tea, which was definitely like before your time, not knowing that was going to be like the catchphrase nowadays.
Who knew? Nobody knew.
And that group would lead you to actually meeting James M2ME. How was that? How exciting was that whole process, especially knowing that the group and the first demos didn't actually work out well because you and James actually lived in the same town when you went home?
You actually read the bio. You actually read the bio. I am so impressed. I am so impressed
by you, so I had to make sure.
Oh my goodness.
I'm so impressed by you.
But
honestly, how was that process? Like, having that moment with him, it not working out, you going back home, and you reaching out to him and you connecting and it being such a powerful connection.
But you know what? Back then he was just starting to work in R&B, and we were trying to go from gospel music to R&B. So it was like, even though he was famous in his own right in the jazz world, he was trying mm-hmm. to start doing R&B music. And he had been his partner, Reggie Lucas, may he rest in peace, were writing, playing for Roberta Flack. And so he was playing. So he was just starting to delve into the R&B, and then he decided they wanted to write songs and they wanted people to sing their songs. So they were looking for a group to produce. And a lawyer, an attorney by the name of Louise West, who was at Howard at the time, knew him, and she said, "I know these kids that sing. You should come down and hear them perform." And he and Reggie came down to Howard to listen. And like, you know, like you said, that didn't work out. But I knew who M. Toomey was because I used to read a magazine called Downbeat. I used to read the jazz magazines. And he would always win all these awards for percussion playing. So I didn't know how to pronounce his name. So when Louise said, "This is James M. Toomey," I said, "Are you James M-T-U-M-E?" Because I would see his name in the magazine. He was shocked that I even knew who he was. And he said, "Yeah, I read Downbeat, you know, blah, blah, blah." And let me tell you, I was such a introvert, but that I love to read. And so I knew about him, but I never expected to meet him. And I had never heard him play, but I would read about how great he was. And he would read these win these international polls for the best percussionist. So it's like, oh, wow, he must be pretty good. So when I actually met him, it was like, I can't believe this. I met somebody famous. You know, but we became good friends. And I, like you said, after I came home from college, I called him and he said, well, he was thinking about starting a group. And would I be interested in singing in his group? And it's like, sure, he lived right across town. It's like, not a problem. So that's how it started. And then they got production deals, and they would allow me to hire singers to sing on these records that they were starting to produce. And nobody knew who they were in the R&B world. So it was like, who's this girl calling up about a session? Because, you know, I'm the new kid on the block. Who is she? And I would come in because I was teaching school. I was a substitute teacher. And it's like, I don't know if this music thing is going to work, so I got to have a job. So I was subbing and going to sessions, getting on the bus, couldn't even drive, getting on the bus, go to New York City to do these sessions with these people. And it's like, okay. And then what happened was the work started to pick up, and I could make more in one day doing a session than I could all week subbing. And it's like, oh, I think I might try this music thing. I think this will work out for me.
Yes. I mean, talk about a blessing.
I can always go back to teach. Yeah, absolutely. And nothing was planned, Marquis. Nothing was planned. Everything was like, I'm just going to see what's going to happen. I'm just going to let it roll, you know, because I didn't want to look in the mirror 20 years later and say, what would have happened if I had called M. Toomey? You know what I'm saying? If I hadn't called M. Toomey, you know, I didn't know where I would be, you know? But I chose the right path, you know, and, you know, the divine intervention and all that. I've chose the right path, and I've worked steadily, you know, and made great music. That was the whole point. We were making great music. And from M. Toomey, I met Luther, and because I called Luther. I called Luther.
You
for
called him?
A job. I hired Luther. That's how I met Luther. I hired him for a session that M. Toomey was doing.
Oh my goodness.
And so we met, and Luther and I clicked, and it's like, oh, I would love to sing with you. And you know, and it's like, he had a group. Wait a minute. Okay. There's so many things. It's so much. Luther was also he was a famous background singer. So I called him to sing on the M. Toomey project. And it's like, he liked me, and it's like, oh, he, the funniest man in the world, Luther was. He, he was starting to get his, I sang on his demo for Never Too Much, which was his first big solo record. And because that's how close we were. We were great friends. And I sang on his demo, and then I sang on every Luther record except for one when Juicy Fruit came out, because I was working with Entune. That's the only record that I didn't sing on from Luther. But everything was connected. I mean, New York City at that time was a serious hub of music, and all these projects going on, and just every day you could work on a different project. It was a wonderful thing. And so, and then Toomey and Reggie becoming these great producers, it's like, oh my God, what I didn't even know I was in the midst of all of this. I mean, you know, you don't realize that somebody's a legend until it's like years later. It's like, oh my God, I worked with Phyllis Hyman. I worked with Stephanie Mills. Oh my God. And all the songs they wrote were hits. It's like, oh my God, I was paying my tithes, you know. I didn't stop paying my tithes.
Oh my goodness.
You know?
Yes, and this is why I'm so excited for you. I'm so excited to be speaking with you. Like, it's incredible. Mm-hmm. Like, I am also a singer-songwriter, and, like, you are so inspiring to me.
Thank you.
I mean, your whole thought process behind being able to fuse yourself into every opportunity and not be limited with your thought process. You have your own solo album out. You are working on a new solo album, I've heard.
Yes.
And you have done all of this amazing singing on all of these amazing, incredible albums.
The opportunities just kept coming because people liked what I was doing. And, you know, people say you have to be in the right place at the right time, but you also have to be prepared. You have to be prepared.
Yes.
If you say you're gonna be like the singer, you got to be prepared. Because, I mean, I not only did the R&B, I mean, I've worked with Lenny Kravitz, I've worked with David Bowie, I've worked with, of course, Luther, Aretha, Dave Matthews, and this group called, Dave Matthews, love them, and this group called Chromeo, which is like, and they're from Canada, I love them so much, and these people always, they continue to call me for work, you know, so it's like, okay, you know, you've got to be able to, if you leave a situation, you have to be able to go back. You have to leave, like, in good standing, you know. So, you know, I get along with everybody, and I do what I'm supposed to do. I'm prepared. I learn the music. I teach the music to the other singers. And it's like, let's go on and remember what we represent, you know. And so we can just go all around the world singing with different people. And it's like, it's fun, but it's also a learning thing because you see different people from other cultures and other nationalities. Mm-hmm. It's like being on Howard's campus, but you're in an airplane, you know?
Yes.
It's like,
what an analogy,
God.
Yes.
And you're on an airplane and you're constantly going. I used to keep a bag packed just in case somebody called me for a gig. I mean, it got so busy. My first job out of the country was with a group I didn't even know. But it's like, everybody else knew them. I didn't know. It's like, oh my God. And when we got to Europe, which was like the first tour, it's like, I think I got the artist's room. I think I got Brian Ferry's room. This room is bigger than my apartment. We all had suites, and I thought that was his room, but no, it was mine.
Oh, wow.
So it's like, oh my God. Some people, this is amazing. What a life.
I mean, just incredible. You were definitely in the right place at the right time, for sure.
Oh,
like, I mean, if we have to look that up in the dictionary, it would have to be you there because, I mean, one thing after the other after the next. I mean, it just
But you know what it was?
It was literally like steps up.
But you know what it was? I was always willing to take a chance to try something new. Always willing. So, I mean, I've worked with the country western artists. I mean, it's like, I've done TV work. I've done this thing called the Songwriters Hall of Fame. I've done the Kennedy Center Honors, lot of jingles for radio and television. I've done, like, the late night TV shows.
David Letterman, SNL.
SNL, all the time you don't see the singers. With Saturday Night Live, most of the time I was singing in a booth. So you would never see the singers, but you always heard me. You know, if they did skits, like on Saturday Night Live, and they would start to sing, we would reinforce the people doing the skits. So, but you would never see us. So, I mean, there's work to be done, and it's not always about being in the front. It's not always about being on camera, because you can still work steadily without being seen.
I love that.
All you need to do is get paid. You need to get paid. and then you can do what it is that you want to do. But in the meantime, it's not about being, for me, it's not about being seen. It's about getting the work done and getting in the quality of work and living comfortably. That's the whole thing.
Yes, and I really wish that I could talk to you for another whole day, 2 weeks, a month. I mean, I'm just so encouraged and inspired by you, and I'm sure everyone listening will also be.
Right.
You have been performing a lot. First of all, I mean, I wish I could talk to you about the stories you have from touring with Luther Vandross and Aretha Franklin, and the background to the precise of it all and the professionalism that you had to maintain throughout it all. I can only imagine, because you've always had the callbacks. You've always had the word of mouth. So that speaks volumes for itself.
Right. And back then, there was no social media. So it was definitely word of mouth. It was definitely word of mouth. People liked what you did. It's like, we like this background section. Can you, I worked with a group called Roxy Music. They liked what we did. They said, the police came to see the show. Sting and the police came to see the show. Could your singers come out with us? But you know what happened?
Yes.
Juicy Fruit came out. So I couldn't go out and tour with the police. Because Juicy Fruit
was mega. There was a mega hit, and I mean, to this day, it has longevity, and it will forever, because it's just
thank,
that great.
Thank God for that. Thank God.
Yes,
for that.
I mean, congratulations to you guys for that. Yes,
thank you, and thank you for samples. Sampling. It's one of the most sampled hip hop songs. You know.
Yeah, I heard it's like more than 70 samples.
Yeah.
Not 70, more than 70.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like,
I mean,
that's incredible.
I love it.
Yes. I wish that I could talk to you forever. I really do. But I know I'm going to have to wrap it up. But I just want to say congratulations to, I mean, I wish I can literally touch on every single thing that has happened to you in your career, because it's so humbling to hear you be so kind-hearted. You're so open to so many opportunities.
Yes,
it
you have to be. You can't close yourself off. You can't say, I'm the only one, or this is what I'm it. No, because there's always somebody to replace you. Always.
Yes,
you're
extremely knowledgeable. Yes, you're extremely knowledgeable.
Yeah.
I can only imagine what you're going to do with this new project that's coming out, because I've heard that you're going to have young producers on it.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
I can only imagine, because the voice is, oh, goodness, your voice.
Thank you.
Yes, yeah, so I wish you... Well, I mean, everyone knows you from knowing Juicy Fruit, knowing the sample that Keisha Cole did, of course, knowing the sample that Biggie Smalls did.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I really, really want and hope that everyone of all ages really can look up to what you have done in this industry and know that with your type of thought process, they can really have longevity in the industry, no matter how many ways it changes. And that is so important. Yes.
Very extremely. It's extremely important.
Can you tell everyone how they can keep in contact with you? I did see your IG page. Oh, my. Who threw your page? It looks so good.
I have a wonderful young lady that takes care of my social media. And but you can reach me at Tawatha AG. That's it. On Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. At Tawatha AG, TawathaAGEE. One word.
Yes.
At Tawatha.
Yes.
AG. Yep. Very simple
to really
reach.
Yes, and I really encourage everyone to continuously follow along, because you're just amazing at all times.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. But you know, the best part about it is that I'm still able to do what I love to do. And it, you know, Juicy Fruit came out in 1983, and I'm still singing. I'm still singing. This is the next segment.
Is this the 35th anniversary of that song?
35th anniversary of Juicy Fruit. Yes, yes.
Yes.
And I continue
with the Roots.
I did.
The
Pre-Grammy
Award.
Much fun.
Yes.
Girl, I have a wonderful wonderful life. That's all I can say. And it's not like I'm gone every day, but I can look back on what I've done and say, oh my God, look at this. This is amazing. Mm-hmm. What a story.
Yes.
What a story. And I'm continuing to do it. This is the next chapter of my life, the next chapter of Tawafa Ages. You know, I've done the M2May thing. We've had the big hit. I've toured with everyone internationally and done a lot of TV and stuff. Now it's like, let me do something for myself. Just Tawafa, just for Tawafa. And, you know, and go out like that. You know what I mean? Just go out like that. Just, I'm enjoying what I'm doing, looking forward to this new project and working
yes.
with M2May and other young producers just to keep it going. Because, you know, you don't just stop because people think the only thing I've ever done was Juicy Fruit. They don't know. They've heard me, like, probably every day of their life.
Hey, okay, hello. They better recognize, they better read them liner notes. They better read them notes on them daggone CDs. I know that we have MP3 and digital everything now, but I mean, goodness, the actual
yeah.
intangible product is still so important, and I need people to still utilize
Absolutely.
Their ability to read. Because you
oh,
have
yeah.
definitely been everywhere and on everybody's album, and it's just incredible.
Oh, you know, it's fun. All I can say, it's fun, and I've been enjoying it. And I enjoy the creative process, and I enjoy working with people and singing for people and talking to kind people like yourself.
Well, thank you so much. I mean, I want to
yes.
make sure people know that if they are in California, you are performing in August at the Funk Fest.
Yeah, August the
yes.
August the 4th, and it's going to be such a great lineup with Morris Day and the Time and the Barcade
oh
and Mary Jane Girls and the Dad Band, Evelyn Champagne King, Howard Johnson, and some other people that I can't think of right now. But
oh
that's
my
August
goodness.
The 4th in Anaheim, California. It's going to be great.
Yes.
The Funk Fest.
I know it's going to be great. I wish I could be there. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I'm so excited for you. I'm so excited for everything that's coming to you, everything that's already happened to you. You are highly blessed and favored.
Oh, yes,
and I
appreciate that. I really do. I realize that I am blessed and highly favored. I realize that.
Yes, and I really appreciate having this moment to speak with you.
It's been my pleasure.
I'm going to leave you alone because I will take up your whole day if you don't just phone me now.
Oh, no. It's been such a pleasure speaking with you, and I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to you.
Yes, thank you so, so much. I will be keeping out an eye for your album and just keeping up with you. I love the picture on your website and that you also have on your Instagram with the dress that you have. It's by a sophisticated...
Sophistafunk.
Yes.
Sophistafunk,
the skirt company. I think that's... Oh, it's so cute. You look so good. I can't tell what picture is from what year. This is incredible.
Oh,
your DNA. Your DNA needs a round of applause, okay?
Oh, yes, yes. Thank God for the parents and the genes.
Yes.
Thank God for genetics. Thank God for genetics.
Yes.
Thank God.
Thank
yeah.
you so, so much. I wish you
it's
the
been
best
my pleasure.
In everything. Yes.
Oh,
you
thank
have a
you
wonderful
so much,
rest
sister.
Of your day.
You too. Bye.